We all use Google services, and we probably have a Google account, whether it's from the company or private, to authenticate against them all, whether it's Gmail, or whether it's the calendar, or it's Maps, or Search even, YouTube. And there's this one account that we use for this. And there is an API that handles all those authentications in a simple way for us all. And there is a hidden feature in that, and that causes a lot of trouble at the moment. And the bad news of today is that there is no remediation yet as of the taping of this Threat Talk. So today's subject is a deep dive on the Google Multi-Login Authentication. And I welcome you from the Security Operations Center floor here at OnToIt. My name is Leo-Jan Koning, and I'm CTO of OnToIt. Let's get on to it.
Welcome to Threat Talks. Let's delve deep into the dynamic world of cybersecurity.
Let me welcome my two guests, Luca Cipriano, he's a threat intel specialist, and Rob Maas, who is the field CTO. Gentlemen, the multi-login hidden feature. Let's start, Luca. A hidden feature in an API of Google. I mean, how in the first place did we find out then if it's hidden and secret and undocumented?
Yeah, well, this proves that attackers are really smart. They're getting even smarter. And I would assume that the attacker then started to basically check the source code, the Chrome OAuth source code, to find out about this endpoint, which was not documented.
But it's the Chrome browser that it is. That source code isn't.
We're talking here about Chromium. Chromium, basically. Yes. So.
Well, Rob actually talked a lot about Chromium from time to time.
I remember that as well.
Continuously, every day. You won't shut about. What's this? What's the relationship?
Chromium is basically a web render engine. It's a platform or a part of a lot of browsers. So a lot of browsers will use Chromium to make sure that the web pages are displayed correctly. So if you visit a website, that is being rendered and displayed correctly on your site. And it's by far the most used web engine. So if you make a page that doesn't comply with the Chromium standards, then probably it isn't displayed as good as you want it to be on every device. And Chromium is being used by a lot of browsers, and also by Chrome, of course. The hidden feature or the vulnerability they found out is basically in the source code of Chromium. So it's there for everyone to use and read.
Okay, so that's much easier than going to the binary and reinvestigating that in the source code. And
yeah, it's still difficult, I would say, because you
probably
need
a
to
lot
have,
of
like,
source code.
Yeah, you need to read, go through the whole source code. You don't know what you're looking for. So.
It's not documented, so you also need to figure out how to use it.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Yeah, and some trial and error probably, but
indeed. That's not straightforward. This is complex.
So what if I am an attacker and I want to exploit this vulnerability, what do I need to do prior?
This has been found on a malware, an info stealer. So as an attacker, of course, there are two prerequisites for this attack to work. So the first one is that I somehow managed to infect your device. So with social engineering tricking you to install something malicious or actively putting the malware on your host. And the second is that, basically you as a user, as a victim, you should have authenticated at least once with your Google account on your Chrome browser.
That one is easy. The second one is easy, right? That happens all the time. Yeah. But the first time, I mean, Rob, we are protecting against this thing. You're infected with malware.
Yeah, so, but the downside, of course, is there's no 100% protection. So we can put a lot of measures in place to prevent Luca from installing his malware.
It's always me.
It's always you. Yeah. We can have endpoint detection and response software, EDR software, that detects processes, malicious activity on an endpoint. But also, even if that EDR fails, then hopefully we have some kind of network firewalling rules in place that block outgoing access to his to Luca's command and control server or to a new domain or newly registered domains, malicious domains, everything that we know basically what is bad, we should block. And that makes it difficult for Luca to install his malware, and even if it is installed, to use his malware.
But would you say that if you are in this place, this malware is installed, it's already gone too far, basically? I mean,
yeah, then it's already, then at least the first step you have lost. The foothold is there, and then the attacker tries to go to the next step, and that's basically what Luca's
Yeah, but now. it kind of can happen all the time. Like, for example, if you think about your antivirus solution, the simple fact that your antivirus requires updates, it means that there are things that before were not detected that now it can detect. So if you got infected at a point where it was not detected and you didn't know, then of course, you get infected. And also, as Rob mentioned, there are several things that you can do. Also block, prevent connection with IPs or URLs to known command and control server. But for people that are familiar with the pyramid of pain, they know that there's like some IOCs that are trivial for an attacker to change in case they are detected. And these are like, for example, a file hash. That's quite simple to change, or an IP address. Maybe a domain or a URL is a bit more difficult because the attacker needs to register a new domain. But still,
it's basically not a cat and mouse game. Eh? Yeah. So I block something and then you change the IP address or the domain, and then yes. I block that again, and then we go forward and back. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we should assume that at some point we have malware on our endpoint. Actually, next week we're going to talk about that if your endpoint management system is actually used to deliver that malware everywhere. So
yeah, that's also something.
Granted, let's assume that indeed there is malware now on an endpoint with a browser endpoint. In this case, we mean a laptop or a workstation or VDI desktop, those kind of things, right? Then what happens here? What does the malware do?
Yes. Okay. So the first thing that the malware will do after infecting is that basically it will retrieve an encryption key that is stored in the Chrome's local state within the user data directory. And this is like a key that is similar to the one used for storing passwords on the browser. And after it retrieves this key, then the malware will basically target the Chrome's token service table of web data. And it's a table that basically contains the Gaia ID, the account ID, and also the encrypted token, which is basically consistent what is stored for you to stay authenticated, basically, once you're authenticated.
Are we talking about things here that are stored within the browser or the data of the browser on your computer?
Yes, indeed.
Right? A key that encrypts your tokens and the tokens itself.
The key is used to decrypt basically the token.
Yeah, you can compare this with cookies that the browser also will use to keep you logged in on your personal social media websites, for example, that you don't have to type in your username and passwords every time.
Yeah, this happens all the time. It happens also at the host level. Like, for example, when you use a password, it will be in memory, because otherwise it will be annoying for a user to be triggered continuously to be authenticated. So,
yeah, so
because, for user experience.
Yeah, even if you have multi-factor, especially if you have multi-factor authentication, I mean, there's strong authentication, but then that leads into a token that is stored somehow that's reused all the time.
Yes.
So you don't have, on every click, have to put a new token code in.
Yeah, basically. Exactly.
And this is the thing this malware is after.
Yes, it leverages this endpoint that was not documented, which is called the multi-login endpoint.
In this case, it's an API endpoint. It's not
a machine. Yeah, that's good that you mentioned. It's just an API endpoint. Basically this
the Google server, so it's connecting to the Google server. This is the
for the authentication. Yes. Yeah. This endpoint is a critical part of the Google OAuth authentication system. And basically it is used for synchronizing Google accounts across services. So to make sure that you are synchronized once you are basically logged in. Thanks to this endpoint, what the attacker can do, it can use the decrypted token with the ID and then generate a new token, basically.
Wait a second. So the multi part is for multiple servers of Google.
Yes.
And somehow you can ask it, you provided the token, and it will get you a new token.
Yes. That's
without,
how it's used.
Without a new re-authentication of the password.
And this is the fact that it will bypass multi-factor authenticator, but it will also survive a password reset. So you don't need a new password to generate it, because you use an existing one, basically, together with this multi-login endpoint to generate a new one.
Yeah, so at this point, the user didn't provide the password, well, in the past, but that happens all the time.
In the past, yeah.
And multi-factor, and Google then creates. Rob, this sounds awful to me.
Yeah, yeah, it is. And it's also a debate if whether this is a vulnerability or a feature. So Google still says this is a feature, we need it. But it can be misused, and especially that even resetting your password is not sufficient is in this case terrible.
Yeah.
What can you do?
Because once you find out that there is some, let's say, mysterious activity or things you don't find normal, you can go to your device management page on Google and see all the sessions that are created, and you can also kill them. If there are any strange sessions there, then you also should look for malware on your system. So do
a session that means basically means systems or applications that have a token like this.
Exactly. Yeah. So a session is basically in this case a token for a system.
How do you do this? I'm a user. I'm curious. How many people are using a token of mine? If it's so easy to create a new one for malware.
Normally, it's only for your account and only your machines. Mm-hmm. So it should be very limited. But if you have multiple devices,
how do I check this? Can I do that today?
Yeah, you can go to the Google, your Google settings and then to your Access Device Management page, and there all the sessions are displayed.
I will put a link in the show notes then.
Yeah, we can do that. Yeah. And then if you remove them all, then you need to re-authenticate and create a new token. But if you don't go to the root, to the malware in this case, then the attacker is also able to create the new sessions. So if you find any sessions there that should not belong there, then scan your system and make sure that
either re-image your system or just try to remove the infection. Exactly. That will be the first step, of course.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, the second step. The first one is close the sessions.
But I doubt that anyone or the average person actually checks their sessions regularly.
No, there should be a real indicator that something is going wrong. Otherwise, people are not going there and not seeing that there are sessions that are should not belong there. So if the attacker is careful in this case, then he can go unnoticed for a long time.
So if you somehow fear that you have weird activity in your Google account, then what you should do is of course change your password. Well, that shouldn't even be necessary.
In general, I will say yes, because in general, it's always better because you don't know that when something happens. So yeah, that's the best, a good practice to do anyway.
But that's not enough.
But still, it's not, this specific, it's not going
to
be
It would be good to have just a reminder every week or every month to go over your sessions. It's like rebooting your router we discussed earlier, but nobody's going to do that.
And it's not just Google then. Probably also your Microsoft account, your Apple account. In Netflix, I know. Because when my third iPad wants to authenticate to get into...
So for the stored sessions, it's the same. But the MultiLogin API, as far as we know now, is specific to Google. So Google has this API that only needs the stored credential of the Chrome users database to create a new token. And for the other ones, you often need to really log on again and provide your username, password, and probably also a multi-factor token to create that new session on that new system.
Would you say in general, if in cases where you have to reset your password, it's also a good practice to go look into the sessions of that authentication system? So suppose my Netflix account
is cannot hurt. So it's always good to check, hey, do I still know all these devices? Or maybe you have shared your account. If you have shared your account, you should not do that, but maybe someone else shared it again and then you have multiple sessions.
Yeah, that's a good practice to do. And on a side note, it does not really apply to this, but for people that maybe they use cryptocurrency, you have basically the same function on your crypto wallet and you can see on which DApp you are authenticated. And I'm mentioning it because sometimes I check it and then I disconnect from DApp that I don't, also because we're talking about
and
money.
And DApp is?
A decentralized application. But that's about something about crypto. That's not really relevant to this, but it's the same mechanism, basically.
That's just good practice to check.
It's good practice to check the session that you have active with. Yeah.
Okay, clear. At least something we can do all. One last thing. This is a lot of intel that has gained from this particular attack. Huh? So how did we find out? How did the good guys find out?
Well, I think that this is quite sophisticated in itself. First of all, because they had to find this undocumented feature and then they had to create a whole system. But what makes it also a bit more complex to understand is the fact that the token is basically encrypted and then sent encrypted to the command and control server. So basically, it creates kind of a black box, which it is more difficult for an incident responder to find out how the mechanism actually works. Also, because if I'm not mistaken, it uses the legitimate encryption key that it's stole before, so it seems legitimate. But also, it actually create a black box for other threat actors that they want to try to mimic this attack because they don't know how it is done. It makes it really difficult. So this is one of the cases where human intel helped find out what happened, because they were selling it on the dark web, of course. They managed to get some information while talking to buy the exploit. And basically, thanks to that, they got some information, they got a hunch in which direction to look, they did some tests, and that it was not successful, but then they understood where they had to do the pen test, on which direction they had to go, and then they found out this. So humans are good for this as well.
So this attack may have been out for a long time already, it's just recent that it surfaced.
Yeah, well, thanks, or the function of the malware was not really, because malware often they also do other things, but maybe this was one of the things that malware does, because the info stealer can steal information of, and then it's implemented on an existing malware as well. So,
all right. Well, I'm certainly going to check my sessions in to any account that I can think of later today. I hope you do the same. Thank you for watching Threat Talks, and thanks to my guests, Luca and Rob, and hope to see you next time.
Thank you for listening to Threat Talks, a podcast by OnToIt Cybersecurity and AMS-IX. Did you like what you heard? Do you want to learn more? Follow Threat Talks to stay up to date on the topic of cybersecurity.